Actually, I'm going to read it. I'm going to read the chapter verse. Remember Acts 25. If you recall, we finished Acts. Need some light. Acts 24, which is surprisingly right before Acts 25. Porcius Festus took over for Felix after 2 years. Paul's in prison. And that's kind of where this picks up. Paul was just kind of left there. Felix is trying to do the Jews a favor after they had accused him of. He was captured by the commander down in Jerusalem, brought up Caesarea by night. So they've got him up here now. Felix, you know, they didn't have any valid reason to have him there, but Felix trying to just kind of win some political favor with them. After all, he's in Caesarea, which is where Rome is ruling, I should say, Israel. That's where they are ruling Israel from, is in Caesarea. So just to gain some political capital with them, or he just left Paul in the prison. And that's kind of where we pick up in 25. Now when Festus had come to the province, after 3 days, he went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem. Then the high priest and the chief men of the Jews informed him against Paul, and they petitioned him, asking a favor against him, that he would summon him to Jerusalem while they lay in ambush along the road to kill him. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept in Caesarea, and that he himself was going there shortly. Therefore he said, "Let those who have authority among you go down with me and accuse this man to see if there is any fault in him." And when he had remained among them more than 10 days, he went down to Caesarea. And the next day, sitting on the judgment seat, he commanded Paul to be brought. When he had come, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood about and laid many serious complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. While he answered for himself, "Neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I offended anything at all." But Festus, wanting to do the Jews a favor, answered Paul and said, "Are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and there be judged before me concerning these things?" So Paul said, "I stand in Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews I have done no wrong, as you very well know, for if I am an offender or have committed anything deserving of death, I do not object to dying. But if there is anything..." What's going on over here? "If I have done anything deserving of death, I do not object to dying. But if there is nothing in these things of which these men accuse me, no one can deliver me to them. I appeal to Caesar." Then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, "You have appealed to Caesar? To Caesar you shall go." And after some days, King Agrippa and Bernice came to Caesarea to greet Festus. When they had been there many days, Festus laid Paul's case before the king, saying, "There is a certain man left a prisoner by Felix, about whom the chief priests and the elders of the Jews informed me when I was in Jerusalem, asking for a judgment against him. To them I answered, 'It is not the custom of the Romans to deliver any man to destruction before the accused meets the accuser's face to face and has opportunity to answer for himself concerning the charge against him.' Therefore, when they had come together, without any delay, the next day I sat on the judgment seat and commanded the man to be brought in. When the accusers stood up, they brought no accusation against him of such things as I supposed, but had some questions against him about their own religion and about a certain Jesus who had died, whom Paul affirmed to be alive. And because I was uncertain of such questions, I asked whether he was willing to go to Jerusalem and there be judged concerning these matters. But when Paul appealed to be reserved for the decision of Augustus, I commanded him to be kept till I could send him to Caesar. Then Agrippa said to Festus, 'I also would like to hear the man myself.'
Tomorrow, he said, you shall hear him. So the next day, when Agrippa and Bernice had come with great pomp and had entered the auditorium with the commanders and the prominent men of the city, at Festus' command, Paul was brought in. And Festus said, King Agrippa and all men who are here present with us, you see this man about whom the whole assembly of the Jews petitioned me, both at Jerusalem and here, crying out that he was not fit to live any longer. But when I found that he had committed nothing deserving of death, and that he himself had appealed to Augustus, I decided to send him. I have nothing certain to write to my Lord concerning him. Therefore I have brought him out before you, and especially before you, King Agrippa, so that after the examination has taken place, I may have something to write. For it seems to me unreasonable to send a prisoner and not to specify the charges against him. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you, God, for this narrative that you've given us. A picture into Paul's last days and how his strength remained and how he was a disciple even then. And God, I pray, Lord, that you use your word, God, to shore up our hearts, to give us strength, to examine ourselves. God, I pray, God, that you would use this time, that your spirit would transform us, God, that these words would not just be spoken here, but God, that you would use them for us to meditate on, to think on, that you would change our hearts with them. God, we thank you. I thank you for these men. I thank you, God, for the freedom we have to meet. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All righty. So again, here we are. Felix has left. Festus has come in. Kind of reminds me, if you think about this, we're right in the middle of a new administration season where we have a change of administration in America. And this is kind of what's happening here. Felix is out. We've got a new administration here with Festus coming in. And early on in his administration, he's the procurator of Israel. He's in Caesarea. They rule Israel out of Caesarea. So he comes in 3 days after he's there. He immediately goes where? He goes to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the capital. It is the heart of. It is, you know, the where all the important people as far as Israel live. The high priest, the temple, everything is there. And so these are the people that he's come to rule over, and it's not, he's not king, he's not the ruler, he's not Caesar, but he's really there. And the king here that we run into, King Agrippa II, is the king here. He's what was called a client king. He was king of Israel, but he was king at the leisure of Caesar, and the procurator was there to make sure that this king was not stepping too far outside of his bounds of what Caesar would want him to do and say and whatnot. So he was king, but, you know, somewhat of a puppet king. They called it, you know, historians have called it a client king. And so immediately, though, and this is a political position that Festus has, immediately, though, he runs down to Jerusalem. And we find, he goes down to Jerusalem, and we find that immediately, when he gets there, the high priest and the chief men of the Jews informed him against Paul. If you recall from the last chapter, they had taken a oath that they weren't going to eat again until Paul died. This is 2 years later, so they're probably pretty hungry. Joke, sorry. Wah, wah, wah. But anyway, they had obviously not let this issue go. It was still a big deal to them. 2 years later, they're still, the first thing they talk about, as far as we know, is Festus shows up, the new procurator, and they want to
what are we going to do about Paul? We see further on in this chapter that he takes that. He's 2 weeks into his, you know, headship in this area, and he makes this like a top priority to figure out what to do with Paul. If you go back, he spends 10 days in Jerusalem. He goes there after 3 days. He spends 10 days there. The next day when he gets back in Caesarea, he brings Paul in. So he made it a very high priority that he would take care of this. Let's read. Now when Festus had come to the province after 3 days, he went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem. Then the high priest and the chief men of the Jews informed him against Paul, and they petitioned him, asking a favor against him that he would summon him to Jerusalem. And this is kind of parenthetical. I don't know if they actually told Festus this was their plan. I'm assuming not. But then he says something later that almost indicates he knew. But it's what? So asking a favor against him that he would summon him to Jerusalem while they lay in ambush along the road to kill him. I'm assuming they didn't tell him that, you would think. But, you know, there's a statement made later that it seems almost as though, if we go back here to, but I mentioned to them, it is not custom of the Romans to deliver any man to destruction before the accused meet the accusers face to face. Almost sounds like they just came out and said, we'd really like you just to send him down here so we can off this guy. It'd really clean up a big political mess. You'd do us a big favor. Come on. We'd really be on your side. We won't cause any problems for your rule here. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept at Caesarea and that he himself was going there shortly. Therefore he said, let those who have authority among you go down with me and accuse this man to see if there is any fault in him. And when he had remained among them more than 10 days, he went down to Caesarea, and the next day, sitting on the judgment seat, he commanded Paul to be brought. When he had come, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood about and laid many serious complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. And it's interesting, Dr. Luke here highlights this as many serious complaints. So from his perspective, these are serious things that are being that Paul is being accused of. We get Festus's opinion of these many serious things a few verses later, and he's like, I was expecting they had something real to accuse them of. These didn't even seem like anything of consequence. They were just things to do with their religion and blah blah blah. But Luke obviously considered them major. Not that they could prove it, but they accused him of what Dr. Luke felt to be major things. While he answered for himself, neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I offended in anything at all. But Festus, it seems again, just like with Felix. Felix knew that Paul was not guilty, but he wanted political favor. Festus, it certainly seems here that Festus agrees that Paul is not guilty, but wanting political favor. But Festus, wanting to do the Jews a favor, answered Paul and said, are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and there be judged before me concerning these things? So Paul said, I stand at Caesar's judgment seat where I ought to be judged. To the Jews I have done no wrong, as you very well know. For if I am an offender or have committed anything deserving of death, I do not object to dying. But if there is nothing in these things of which these men accuse me, no one can deliver me to them. I appeal to Caesar. And this was his right as a citizen born of the Roman Empire. He had the right, when he was accused of something, to appeal to Caesar. It was dangerous because Caesar's judgment was final. There was no further appeal. So you want to go there as your last resort, and I don't know that this was necessarily the last resort, but I think the reality is that Paul knew that God had called him to be, to witness to Caesar. And this was how he was going to get there. So he, and I think it's interesting, Paul knew well that his life was dialing to an end, and but he didn't show fear. He didn't show any concern of the matter. He just, this is the next step. I'm heading to Caesar. He probably knew from the Lord what was already going to happen. There's an interesting series out there called The Truth Project. I don't know if you've heard of The Truth Project. It's really a really good discussion series put out by Focus on the Family. Just kind of how then shall we live? Kind of a applying, if you believe this, then this is how that applies to politics. This is how that applies to sexual relations. This is how that applies to different areas in your life. How does this apply? And a common saying that they have that's really sounds silly, but if you chew on that for a minute, it's you know, it'll make you think. Do you really believe that what you believe is really real? Do you really believe that what you believe is really real? About Jesus, about the resurrection, about coming heaven. All those things, do you really believe that it's really real? And I think many times we don't live a life that would indicate that we believe that's really real. I'm not saying we're being hypocritical, like, I'm telling you I believe it, but there's a reality sometimes of the actions we take are evidence of what we really believe. And so in that, examine yourself, examine your heart, examine would I be doing this if I really believed that Christ died on the cross for my sins? If I really, really believe this? If I really believe that there's an eternal heaven and an eternal hell, and this guy right here, right now, he's not going to heaven. If I really believe that, hey, bud, see you later. For me, that's, you know, there's way too many times that I walk the path of not doing what I should have done because it's easier to do the other thing, just being honest. And so write that down. Do you really believe that you believe that what you believe is really real? Think on that. Paul really believed that what he believed was really real. He knew beyond a shadow of doubt and was willing to go through anything. You get this mindset that, you know, Paul would just, he'd run through a brick wall if God told him to. He'd go, this one? You want to run through this brick wall? I'm on it. And so he would do it. Then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, "You have appealed to Caesar. To Caesar you shall go." After some days, King Agrippa and Bernice came to Caesarea to greet Festus. And I don't know if King Agrippa and Bernice, who is his sister, had not been in Jerusalem when he had come, because it's almost as though they're now making their political rounds to see the new procurator. I don't know if they weren't there, or if he went down to greet the religious leaders and not the political leaders down there. Don't know. But anyway, they're coming up to Caesarea now to greet him. This is King Agrippa II, son of King Agrippa, who put James in prison and spoke great flowery words, and everybody praised him as though he had the voice of a god, and he took that praise and then fell over, died, and was eaten by worms. That was his father. He is the great nephew of the Herod who killed John the Baptist. He was the great grandson of the Herod the Great, who killed the innocents in Bethlehem. So he was part of this family. He's Jewish. They're Jewish. He's part of the family. He knows well about the Christians. He knows well about Christ. He knows well about John the Baptist. This has been a part of his family legacy of dealing with these people of the way. So, and we'll see here later, next week in 26, that Paul gets in front of him and says, I mean, you're an expert in these matters. I'm glad that I get to speak my piece in front of you, because you know the deal. You know all about this. So this is true. He knows. He is well versed in what's going on in this matter. King Agrippa and Bernice came to Caesarea to greet Festus. When they had been there many days, Festus laid Paul's case before the king, saying, there is a certain man left a prisoner by Felix, about whom the chief priests and elders of the Jews informed me when I was in Jerusalem, asking for a judgment against him. To them I answered, it is not the custom of the Romans to deliver any man to destruction before the accused meets the accusers face to face and has opportunity to answer for himself concerning the charge against him. We get to see a bit of a view of where some of our ideas of innocent until proven guilty and the right to be seen in a court of law and these type of things, that these came from Scripture, also came from the Roman law, and much of our legal system is built on these. Interesting, though, he's been in, on just an accusation, he's been in prison now for 2 years, so there's obviously some wiggle room here on what you can and can't do in Rome. Therefore, when they had come together without any delay, the next day I sat on the judgment seat and commanded the man to be brought in. When the accusers stood up, they brought no accusation against him of such things as I supposed. So they brought many things that Luke considered to be serious complaints. But Festus sees them, but they had some questions against them about their own religion and about a certain Jesus who had died, whom Paul affirmed to be true. And the Greek, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Steve, is actually continues to affirm, is more of a that he is, continues to say he is alive, as opposed to he was dead and then he was alive again, like one person, like Lazarus was dead and alive and then dead again, but he continues to affirm he is alive. And it's interesting that that's the thing that they bring to the court, because that is the resurrection points to the deity of Christ. Him saying, I'm going to rise again, rising again 3 days later, just like he said, points to his deity, his control over death. And that is the thing that in a Roman court would get you killed. If you know, here this guy is saying somebody other than Caesar is God, or somebody other than who they have allowed you to say is God, or actually, really it's saying somebody is the only God is really the deal. And so he's basically, this is the accusation around his resurrection is what winds up standing out, at least to Festus, of what was accused of. And these are obviously not a big deal to him, at least. And because I was uncertain of such questions, I asked whether he was willing to go to Jerusalem and there be judged concerning these matters. But when Paul appealed to be reserved for the decision of Augustus, I commanded him to be kept until I could send him to Caesar. Caesar at this time was Nero. I don't know, I'm sure you've heard of Nero in history, was a very harsh ruler from what I've read and from what I've heard, there was actually a point in time in his leading that he was not nearly as harsh, not nearly as violent a ruler. And then there became a time where he just became very fierce and very heavily persecuted the church. And it was PD has mentioned that he thinks that when Paul stands in front of him and he rejects Christ at this point, because we know Paul went to him, he shared the gospel, and at this point, Caesar had a point. You can accept Christ or you can turn. And Nero rejected Christ at that point, and then I think his heart was given over to Satan at that point. And it seems historically to be accurate that he's kind of almost two reigns. One reign where he was relatively moderate. The second part of his reign, he was pretty heavily persecuted of Christians. I commanded him to be kept until I could send him to Caesar. Then Agrippa said to Festus, I also would like to hear the man myself. Tomorrow, he said, you shall hear him. So the next day, when Agrippa and Bernice had come with great pomp, they made a big old flowery deal out of it. They put together a big deal at an auditorium, thousands of people probably. These things were built. Obviously, they had PA systems back then. So somebody could sit in the middle of it and drop a coin, and it could be heard at any point of the auditorium. They're amazing structures. So they gathered a bunch of people into this auditorium. King Agrippa and Bernice, they're so important. They get to come in, and lots of pomp and circumstance, and had entered the auditorium with the commanders and the prominent men of the city. At Festus' command, Paul was brought in. And Festus said, King Agrippa, and all men who are here present with you, you see this man, about whom the whole assembly of the Jews petitioned me, both at Jerusalem and here, crying out that he was not fit to live any longer. But when I found that he had committed nothing deserving of death, that he himself had appealed to Augustus, I decided to send him. I have nothing certain to write to my Lord concerning him. Therefore, I have brought him out before you, and especially before you, King Agrippa, so that after the examination has taken place, I may have something to write. He's obviously, it makes sense, and he would probably get in trouble if he sends, hey, Caesar, here's a bad guy. We don't really have anything to accuse him of, just a bad guy. So he's probably protecting his own neck at this point. For it seems to me unreasonable to send a prisoner and not specify the charges against him. At no point, though, does it seem unreasonable, it seems, to both Festus and Felix to just drop the charges. Guy's not guilty. What are we even talking about here? Why are we bothering with this? But I guess the question that is just for me and for you is when you are accused of things, what is your reaction? How do you handle that? I mean, there's a difference. We're accused when we're guilty. How do you react on that? It's important. It shows where your heart is. Because we're going to be guilty of some things. We're going to be accused of some things that we legitimately, sometimes will be a brother or sister will come to us and say, man, I see this in your life, and that's rough. How do you respond to that? The other side of that is, what about when you're innocent? Paul's innocent here. How do you respond to that accusation? It's important that we respond in mercy, we respond in grace, we respond not necessarily trying to hurt the other person. He didn't go about attack. If you notice, Paul wasn't trying to attack them. He was just saying, they don't have proof of this. I'm not guilty. So be aware, think about that when you're accused of things in life. whether it be business, whether it be personal, whether it be with your wife, whether it be whatever. Let's pray. Father God, we love you. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you again for an opportunity as men to sit down together and open it up. I just pray, God, that you bless this this next time together as we sit and minister to one another and pray for one another, God, that you would make it a sweet time, that we would draw near each other, God, and you would build our fellowship. Lord, we love you. We again thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.